I would like to follow on from the keynote presentation this morning that Johan Rockström gave. And I'd like to focus on two of the nine issues for which we have tried to define planetary boundaries, ocean acidification and biodiversity, and go into them in a little bit more detail, both to tell you what some of the consequences are for humanity if we transgress these boundaries, but also in doing so to describe a little bit of the differences amongst the boundaries and some of the difficulties we have in describing or trying to quantify where the boundaries might be. So let's start with ocean acidification. And that's a figure that Johan showed, but it's worth putting it up again. But the basic argument is this. The ocean absorbs roughly 25 to 30% of the human emissions of carbon dioxide. That's a good thing. It takes it out of the atmosphere. It leads to a little bit less warming. But as it dissolves, it increases the acidity of the ocean. As Johan said, it forms an acid called carbonic acid. We learn about this in first year chemistry. But that affects organisms that form calcium carbonate shells. There are some of them. Everyone likes to focus on coral reefs. But also it affects plankton, phytoplankton. This is very important for the ocean's ability, for example, to continue to take up carbon. Crustaceans, mollusks, and so on. And we have little idea of what the impact on these calcium carbonate forming organisms will be for the whole food chain, the entire marine ecosystems. And that's a very, very big question, a big unknown. I wanted to put this graph up again to show you over a very long period of time. This is in millions of years, so we're going back nearly 25 million years. You see that ocean acidity has actually changed quite significantly as carbon dioxide has changed over that time period. So these organisms have had to cope with changes. But look at this right-hand end of this curve. That's the ocean acidity, the pH, which is a measure of acidity, in 1800, just as the Industrial Revolution was getting going. Here it is today in the year 2000. Already a very big shift, which in terms of ecosystem time frame is instantaneous compared to the shifts in the past. We're pretty much committed by 2050 to hitting this level of acidity. Acidity goes up as pH goes down. And a business as usual by 2100 would put us here, much more acidic than any other time in the last 25 million years. And it will occur basically within two or three centuries, which is an instant in terms of evolutionary time frame. So this is an important point, not only in this, but in many other aspects of the impact of climate change and other global changes on human societies and on ecosystems. It's happening much, much faster than the adaptive capacity is capable of dealing with. This is trying now to put two of the planetary boundaries together on the same graph, a so-called double whammy, if you like, for coral reefs. So on the vertical axis, we have a temperature change compared to today's temperature. On the horizontal axis, up on the top, is atmospheric CO2. But on the bottom, that's translated into a carbon ion concentration when you take into account the dissolution of that CO2 and its chemistry in the surface waters of the ocean. Now, we've defined a quadrant here where coral reefs are quite happy. Carbonate ion concentration is high enough that they thrive, and temperature is low enough that they don't bleach. In fact, we can plot between glacial and interglacial environments the environment that coral reefs have lived in. So this is the interglacial. This is the last 10,000 years, the Holocene, as Johan described. And you see that the corals are in can survive periods of some warming, but they certainly can't survive anything more than 2 degrees warming. Here's where we are today. So we've taken a 1990 or 2000. Temperature is zero on this graph. But we can see that the carbonate ion concentration has already decreased quite considerably. I've put here the proposed acidification boundary that you'll find in our paper in Nature of last year. It's slightly higher than this graph, but it's entirely consistent with it. But the point is, a business as usual will take us along this path to point B and then to point C. In this upper quadrant, it's both too warm and it's too acidic for coral reefs to exist. So in fact, this is a good example of the interactions between these planetary boundaries. They don't operate in isolation. So this is a double whammy that reefs face. As we go through the 21st century, they're warming up, they bleach more often, and when they try to recover from the bleaching event, they're doing so in a marine environment that is more acidic than they're used to. Their calcification rates are already slowing. We've measured a 15% drop in the calcification rate of one of the major coral species in the Great Barrier Reef, and we have over 400 years of data as we drill into that coral. So we know that this is something new and different from what we've seen during the last 400 years. But in fact, it's actually a triple whammy for most of the world's coral reefs. I mentioned two of them. The direct cause, of course, of bleaching is a rise in sea surface temperature above the maximum tolerable one. But in addition to ocean acidity, there are direct human stressors. Effluents, fertilizer runoff, pollutant runoff from the adjacent mainland areas, particularly important in areas like the Caribbean, even somewhat important in off the east coast of Australia. Tourism, fishing, and so on further reduce the resilience of the reef. So basically, three things are hitting the reef all at once. More human pressure as that population goes up and as usage goes up, ocean becoming more acidic, and temperature of the ocean surface waters rising. All of them act together. This is an excellent example of multiple interacting stresses and the need for the next phase of our boundary research to start dealing with how these boundaries interact and how the interaction actually forces us to move the boundaries back even further. Because in isolation, an organism or an ecosystem may survive one boundary, but it cannot survive multiple boundaries approaching their limits. Let's look at another one. I should add, though, on that ocean acidification, we have a very clearly understood chemical reaction that we can use as the basis for our boundary. You notice we put a fairly sharp point because we know at what point calcium carbonate starts to dissolve, at what point of acidity. So that was rather easy for us to set a boundary, and we moved it back a little bit in terms of a bit of a safety margin.